Hello, my fellow rockers. How are you all doing today? We're going to get started with one of those bad boys right there. Welcome back. I'm going to switch to a different camera so I could see the chat. I'm going to say hello to a few of you. And then, as always, I have something very exciting and special that I'd like to share with you today. We're going to take a look at four Fender guitars, three of which you can't buy. For a number of reasons. We're going to go through it. This is all part of my personal collection. Of course, there's one you can buy, but it's a special guitar, and I'm going to save that one for the end. So let me switch cameras. Let me come over here so I could see you all. And let's kick off with a couple of hellos. Okay, all the way to the top. By the way, audio's okay. Sound check. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4. We have Dusty Wilson, first in the house this evening. One of those bad boys right there, RRD, the 11, John Gregory, Guitar Man 45, Tim Thomas, Sasso, and I'm going to scroll to the end of the chat. And if you want to say hello again, and I'll try to say hello to you. AQ Music in the house, Mike is himself, Ike, Darren S., James Norton, John Clark, Gary Davlin, Brian from Oregon, hello, says sounds good. Excellent. Excelente. So, okay, that means we're off to a good start. No technical issues today, thank goodness. So, the goal, as always, for those that are just tuning in, I'm actually on episode 5, which is crazy, where I'm cycling through some of the guitars I have in my personal collection. And the reason why I'm doing this is because every guitar has a story. And I want to share that story with you. And some of them are really interesting. Michael D., hello. Christopher Nyman, hello. Aloha from Cali. Very cool. Randall says his Gamma amp is great. Very cool. Chris Felthausen, you asked me if I was related to the polka player with the same last name. Yes, I am. Oh, really? Interesting. I asked that a while ago. You have a good memory. Better than mine. Okay, so I guess we could jump right into it. Everyone ready? Mr. Mick says I sound tired. So last week, let me give you a quick personal update. Last week I didn't do a live show. I was like down and out. I got COVID. I never had COVID before. Shockingly, I dodged it all through the pandemic. And it caught up with me and I was out. In fact, last Tuesday, I started to lose my voice, tested negative for COVID. Wednesday, I had no voice, still tested negative. Thursday, I had a fever. I was very tired. My throat felt like sandpaper. It was just rough. Called the doctor, did a telehealth thing. Doctor said, sometimes COVID doesn't show up right away. Do it again. She was right. And I had it. And let me tell you, I've had the flu before. I've had bronchitis before, right? We've all been sick. But this knocked me out cold. And I was out cold for like 5 days. I'm talking 14-hour sleeps, on and off fever. My throat, it's funny because my throat and my voice hit me the hardest. It started before I tested positive for COVID. I had no voice, and my voice is still a little shot. So started with the voice, ended with the voice, but there you go. YouTube has you missing the first half of the chat. Oh, maybe. It says top chat. Let me see. Live chat. All messages are visible. Let me go back to the top. See, now it says Tim Thomas, Grandpa Joe. So yeah, maybe it did have me missing, some of the chat. So my apologies. The great Vanzini says, interesting Fenders tonight. It's going to be, well, interesting. Yeah, it will be. John Clark had COVID in August. Same thing. A friend of mine, when he had COVID, he told me buy Cepacol. It's like a throat lozenger. He swore by it, said, buy it. Trust me, you'll thank me later. And let me tell you, he was right. I had Cepacol That was the only thing. It's basically a lozenger. It's the only thing that actually gave my throat relief. That was the, again, my throat, my voice, the sore throat, like nothing I ever felt before. Really, really bad sore throat. And Cepacol, go buy it. You'll thank me later. I'm paying the advice forward. If you haven't had COVID, go get Cepacol. They're little throat lozengers. And let me tell you, it was the only thing that really relieved my throat. Octopus Ears says, I'm gassing super hard for a Les Paul Standard. My wallet isn't doing well with the news. I actually just read an article that guitar sales are down. Imports especially are down. You know, I get all the trade publications, email, snail mail. And that's the big news right now in the guitar world. You know, the guitar universe, not Guitar World the magazine. But in the guitar universe is sales have definitely slowed down. Now, the thing is, I don't know if that means, you have to remember during COVID, Fender said we had record sales, right, in the history of the company. So what it didn't report on, has it slowed down from their record sales, or is it slowed down relatively speaking based on like the past 5 years? That I don't know. John Clark says, same here, orange-flavored Cepacol. Did I get any shot? I did. I got vaccinated. I know there's a lot of controversy over that. I don't want to talk about the controversy. I'm of the opinion everybody should do them, do what's right for you. You know, technically I'm high risk, right? I'm middle-aged. I'm overweight. You know, stuff like that. So, you know, I don't know if anyone knows the real answers on that topic, so we'll just leave it there. James Norton says, so why the layoffs from Fender? Well, if I had to guess, first of all, I don't know. But if I had to guess, I would say that they ramped up based on COVID sales and demand, and they're probably winding down now. That would be my guess based on the economy. That's my best guess. You have to remember, Fender is a factory. And if demand goes down, you have workers that don't have anything to build, right? So it's unfortunate, but I think that might be the reality. Mike is himself, I'm not a high risk, you're a good looking badass guitar player. I'll take that compliment all day long, thank you. Okay, let's get into it. We're going to talk about a couple of Fender guitars that you just can't buy. Hence the title of the video, Fender Guitars You Can't Buy. So I'm going to start with this one right here. Okay, so, and I'll plug it in. We'll do sound samples and all that. I'll give everyone a quick ooh and ah. And let's play a game. Does anybody know why you can't buy this? Cheetah says, who's leading in sales? Any idea? Well, I would imagine somewhere between Fender and Gibson. You know, the big boys are Fender, Gibson, Ibanez, and there's probably one more. Who's the other biggest guitar company out there? Well, those are your top three. I'm pretty sure those are your top three. Brian from Aragon says, PartsCaster. In fact, Brian from Aragon, if you don't mind me sharing this with everyone, he said, if you ever sell that guitar, call me first. That I remembered. What the heck is that thing? Okay, so here's the thing. This was actually one of my, see, this is why I'm doing this series, The Tone Vault. I get to talk about stuff that perhaps you've never seen. This is a PartsCaster. This is a Jazzmaster body, a USA Jazzmaster body. Inside the neck joint, it's actually stamped August 27th, 2015. This was, and the neck on this is a channel bound neck. So if you see, let me roll it a little bit to try to, okay, right there. So if you look at that shot right there, basically the rosewood is inlaid into the maple neck. It's not just rosewood on top of maple, it's inlaid. It's called a channel bound neck. It was found on, I think, Fender Elite Strats. It's also called a select neck. And again, it all has to do with channel bound. In fact, I have an interview with the former CEO of Fender, Larry Thomas. I was asked to take that interview offline. I could probably put it online because when I did the interview, at that time, I was asked very politely by Fender, we shouldn't have done the interview in the back room because there was some stuff out there that hadn't hit the wire yet. It wasn't public knowledge yet. They asked me to remove it. So after this video, I'm going to look for that, and I'll make sure it's live, and I'll also I'll link it in the description. But this is a channel-bound neck, which, according to Larry Thomas in that interview, they applied for a patent on this. Okay, so it's a USA guitar, right? USA neck, USA body. This is a Strat neck, so this is basically supposed to be a smaller scale guitar. So it's basically a Strat guitar, okay? To read you a description, originally introduced with the Fender Select Series in 2013, the channel bound necks have a compound radius fingerboard inlaid directly into the neck, eliminating the side seam between the neck and the fingerboard. In fact, if you look there, there is no side seam. It looks like a like that, you would think it's an all maple neck, but it's inlaid, which is pretty neat. Okay, let me see what else I have. Of course, I put everything here so I have everything and I could share with you what's what. The pickups in here are Lollers. These are called the El Rayo. They're humbuckers. Interestingly enough, the DC resistance is really low on these. It's 3.5 in the neck, it's 4K in the bridge. But they sound really good. They're meant to be a humbucker that sounds like a single coil. So you get the benefits of a humbucker with the tone and the chime of a single coil. Interestingly enough, the bridge is an Alnico 8. You don't see that too often. And the neck is an Alnico 5. The description from Lawler says, with excellent note clarity, for a humbucker, we often describe the dynamics of the El Rayo as having a percussive quality, almost like single coil pickups. The entire frequency response is relatively flat with a typical PAF style humbucker. Okay. And the switching on here is, there's the S1, which I don't know if you could see right over here. That goes, so this goes in and out right there. The way this is wired is a Bill Lawrence RC network configuration. There was an article in Premier Guitar in 2018 called The Sound of Silence. Basically, S1 splits the coils in both pickups, provides thinner chime, less feedback using this Bill Lawrence RC network wired based on the Sound of Silence article from 2018. So the reason why you can't buy this guitar is because it's a parts caster. This does not exist. You can't buy this. And it's a gorgeous guitar. It's a Cheyenne red, I think is the color. It's got the scraped binding, flamed maple top. And it's just a wonderful guitar. I never bought a parts caster. I never thought I would have bought a parts caster during COVID. When everybody was selling their guitars and everybody was buying their guitars. I sold a bunch too. I think I sold maybe 10 guitars that year. I stumbled across this one and I said, wow, that's a good looking guitar. Let me stand up to give you a nice visual. Actually, let me change cameras. Let me come back over here since the chat is on this camera here. Metalhead hippie in the house, dude. One of those bad boys right there. Greg Vanzini says that is a beauty. It's just wow. Lawless to boot. Guy's a genius. So I wound up, I don't know why this one didn't sell quicker. I made him an offer. He actually had it marked pretty low. I made him an offer because he had make an offer. As far as I'm concerned, if someone has make an offer, make them an offer, right? But I made him an offer. I think maybe the offer was minimal, like just to save me some shipping bucks or whatever, shipping and tax. Usually, if the price is good and they have make an offer, I figure, well, if I could get free shipping and cover my tax, you know. But he said no. Oh, Grumpy Mike sent a super chat. Dude, thank you so much. One of those bad boys right there. And Grumpy Mike has an awesome YouTube channel. Go check it out. Go subscribe. He is a good person. Check him out. And again, Grumpy Mike, dude, thank you. And by the way, if I miss a super chat, please like pummel me in the comments. Sometimes I wind up talking, I don't see it, and then I catch someone said, "Oh, did you see the su-?" So if someone does wind up sending me one, you don't have to, but if you do and I miss it, please just everyone let me know so I could be polite and thank them. So anyway, he had said no, which is okay, because I was looking to get rid of some guitars, not buy some, but this was really just a pretty guitar. And then he came back like a week later. In fact, I was at a place called Fish Taco in Long Branch. I remember that, and I was having tacos. Oh no, Surf Taco, excuse me, Surf Taco in Long Branch, New Jersey. And I got the email on my phone, checking phone while eating some tacos. And he was like, "Dude, if you want the guitar, it's yours. Just make the offer again, buy it now, whatever." And I did. And I chatted with him. We actually spoke a little bit, like really just an outstanding experience. He and I spoke on the phone, we communicated over email. And the story behind this guitar for him is he just likes to tinker. He buys parts and puts guitars together. And this one was just a wow guitar for me. And really, talk about best of the best. Really just a premium body from Fender. I think probably as premium gets on the neck. And that's the story of that. So, if you'd like, I'll give you a sound sample. Rob Baker says, "Love me some Surf Taco. Now I'm hungry." Yeah, if you're ever in Jersey, Surf Taco. My son and girlfriend turned me onto that place. So, let's hear how this sounds. Oh, Tactical Six String says, "Born in Long Branch, Red Bank." Oh, cool. Very cool. I was made in New York. I was born in Brooklyn. All right, here we go. So that, my fellow rockers, is the Jazzmaster. A guitar, as promised, that you can't buy. So I'm going to put this one down. I'm going to check the comments, and then I'll go on to guitar number two. Kind of has a frameless look. Well, it's that offset look. Chris was born in Schenectady, New York. I actually went to school in SUNY Albany, not too far from Schenectady. The low outputs are always nice. I enjoy the way pearly gates sound, usually because I have too much dirt going on. You know, you make a really good point. As a kid, I always thought high, like real high outputs. In fact, many years ago, I went into a store not knowing anything. I'm like, give me the hottest pickup you have. They gave me a DiMarzio X2N, and I hated it. I actually think lower outputs are better. You know, 15K and under. I know some people say 15K is a hot output, but some of these just get ridiculous, right, with the resistance. The neck feels like butter. It's a tiny bit on the thicker side. It's not your typical C. It's kind of like a full capital C, you know. But it's a nice guitar. My knees hurt. I have been to Summit, New Jersey. Big bucks in Summit, New Jersey. It's out of my price range. I used to live in Summit. Yeah, Summit's nice. I actually have a couple of friends that live up there. And beautiful. That whole area, what's the other, I want to say Wachung. Wachung, Summit, it's nice areas up there. Grumpy Mike says, I have come to greatly appreciate the offset body, super comfortable to play. So, 15 minutes from Albany. So, you know, that was an interesting guitar for me because it was a parts caster. And there is something really nice about owning a guitar that you can't buy. Like, you feel like you have something special. A lot of my perspective comes from the collector's corner, so to speak. I like to buy, like all of us, right? I like to buy guitars. Luca is in the house. Dude, one of those bad boys for Luca. Luca, for those that don't know, is my co-conspirator partner in Badlands. So it's four of us. It's myself. It's Luca, who's in the chat, which, dude, good morning. Philip McKnight, which you all know, and Trushak, which some of you know. And it's the four of us. So, Luca, I'm so happy you're here. And in case you missed it, Luca, I'm talking about Fender guitars that you can't buy. And this here is a parts caster, which I just covered, which is basically all Fender parts except the Lahler pickups. And beautiful guitar. Okay, so this guitar, are we ready to go on to number two? Jersey top five wealthiest states. Is that right, Tactical Six? Is Jersey one of the top five wealthiest? I know there's big bucks in Jersey, like mega bucks in Jersey, right? You have places like, where does Bruce Springsteen live? Bon Jovi, Rumson, New Jersey, which is insane. You have Saddle River, which is insane. There are homes in Homedale, New Jersey, which look presidential. I would imagine every state has their nice areas. I mean, I live in a nice area. It's not presidential. You know, it's just your nice neighborhood, your everyday, run-of-the-mill nice neighborhood. But there are some, like, legit, like, I'm not even talking mini mansions or whatever they're called, McMansions. I'm talking like legit mansions. I know Connecticut, there's some mega bucks. California, I would imagine. Colts Neck, there you go, Colts Neck. Colts Neck is interesting because, as the name suggests, it's a lot of horse farms. And for horse farms, you need property. So where your average Jersey home, nice Jersey home, is on an acre, these are on like 6 acres. Colts Neck has a massive amount of property. Beautiful, though. Beautiful. Anyway, back to guitars. It's based on income per capita, so it costs more to live. Yeah, gotcha. Okay, back to guitars. So, this guitar here, let me pull up my notes. Anyone want to take a gamble at what we're looking at here? In fact, the back of this says special edition. I'll see if I could share that with you. Hold on. It says special edition. Nope, not the Hendrix. Not the Hendrix. See? That's the thing. Not the Hendrix. Okay, so this one here is a 2007 Fender 60s reverse headstock Stratocaster, not a Hendrix, okay? Basically, it was a Stratocaster. I think it was out for 1 year. There was really nothing special about this, relatively speaking. The neck is really nice. This has kind of the smaller C. A nice high gloss on the neck. Let me see if I could. Oh, there you go. If you look at the lower part, about 7th or 8th, 9th fret, you could see the gloss is really nice. It's gloss and tinted, which is nice. Pretty close to the Badlands tint wise. Kubrick lover, hello. Wayne's World's gone wrong. Yeah, so this here, this is made in Mexico. It came out for about a year. And again, the model is called the Fender 60s Reverse Headstock Stratocaster. Being the rocker that I am, when I saw the reverse headstock on the Strat, I was like, ooh, that's nice. Now, at the time, in 2007, these were selling for $699. Interestingly enough, I didn't want to pay $699. So I wound up, oh no, did I wind up paying $699? I think I bought this from Musician's Friend. I want to say maybe it was Deal of the Day, stupid Deal of the Day. I think they had them on. Because your average Fender guy isn't going to want that. It's not traditional. So that probably also explains why it was only out for a year. You really, you know, it's kind of niche as a niche of a niche, meaning, you know, it's a Strat, but how many Strat people want a reverse headstock Strat? Probably not that many. But to me, it was really interesting. I don't remember how much I paid for it, but knew they were $699. So let's just say deal of the day, I bought this for $500. Okay. Now, what was interesting about this is the pickups that were in there were no-name Fender pickups. Like, there was no name to it. It was just like, they didn't even tell you what the magnet was. They were like El Nico, not like 3, 5, 8, whatever. At the time, I wanted a Yinve Malmsteen Fender Strat. In 2007, they cost $14.99. I don't want to spend $14.99, and even used, they were more than I wanted to spend. So I figured I could buy this, and I can change the pickups. So basically, I have, and by the way, the camera's not picking this up correctly. This is, there you go. That's the color of the guitar. It's the off-white with the white pickguard. If I hold it like that, you could see. Let me give you the shot in a different camera also. There you go. That's actually a better shot. Okay. So what I did was I wound up buying at the time DiMarzio before Yngwie Malmsteen went to Seymour Duncan and made the YJM Fury pickups. DiMarzio made the YJM. Today, that's called the HS4. It used to be called DiMarzio YJM. Today, it's called the HS4. Interestingly enough, the DiMarzio YJM, you would think it was in the bridge, but it wasn't. It was in the neck and the middle position, and they used the HS3 in the bridge. So that's what I did. What I did was I took an HS3, I put it in the bridge, I put a YJM, DiMarzio YJM in the neck, and I took an HS2 and put it in the middle position. Now, what's interesting is DiMarzio sold a pre-wired pickguard back then, 2007, time frame. It was called the YJM pickguard, and they had the YJM in the neck, the HS2 in the middle, and the HS3 in the bridge. But on the Yngwie Malmsteen Fender Strat, it was YJM, YJM, HS3. So there's a little bit of a mystery in terms of why they were never consistent with that middle pickup. Sometimes it was an HS2, sometimes it was a YJM. But being it's a three pickup guitar, I wanted all three. So DiMarzio HS3, DiMarzio HS2, DiMarzio YJM, which is now called the HS4. These are double stacked pickups, which is really designed to get rid of the hum, right? So you preserve the look of the Strat, but you get kind of that higher, gain tone out of it. Let me see if I had any other info. The DC resistance on these are actually pretty high. Let me see if I wrote them down here. Yeah, they're about 15K. No, the middle was 15K. I think the neck and the bridge are higher. I could check it out if you guys want me to check it out. I have a multimeter here. In fact, I could show you how to check it out if you've never done that before. Steve from Boston said, oh, Steve, first of all, Steve from Boston, dude, one of those. And he wrote, depended on what Yngwie had for breakfast. Yep. Noiseless in the sense that they're not single coils, they're humbuckers, right? Today, Fender makes noiseless single coils, but these are actually double stacked humbuckers. Okay. In fact, one of them is a little loose. I should tighten that up. Hang on. Well, I'll do that later. But anyway, so that's the guitar. Again, Fender 60s reverse headstock Stratocaster. So why can't you buy this guitar? Well, first of all, they don't make this guitar anymore. I think that you mentioned they make the Jimi Hendrix, but I didn't want a Jimi Hendrix. Listen, I love Hendrix, but what's nice about this is it's not tied to an artist's name. So you really have a lot going on here. You have the Jimi Hendrix reverse headstock style. You have the Yngwie Malmsteen original DiMarzio pickup in the electronics, and just a beautiful neck, beautiful guitar. So it's kind of also, in a weird kind of way, a parts caster of sorts. Please show you how to measure it. Okay, so I'll do that. So basically, I'll show everyone how to measure the resistance in a pickup. Let me change cameras real quick. Okay, so I think there's a little bit more real estate. So I basically took a cable and I put two little clips at the end. Tip is positive, sleeve is negative, and I put two little what are those called? I forget what they're called. The little like spades, audio spades. So I'm gonna plug this in to the output jack, okay? And then I'm gonna take a multimeter. And what I do is I take my positive. Let me put the multimeter over here for a sec. And I did this so basically I could take my in the camera. So I'm going to take the positive, I'm going to put it in here. I'm going to take the black wire, the ground, put it in there so I don't have to hold it. See that? Okay, and then I could drop that on the floor. Okay, so then what I'm going to do is I'm going to set this to 200K on the multimeter, DCV. Okay, so you could see that the bridge pickup is putting out 22.7. Okay, and of course you want to make sure your volume is all the way on. Let me see if I could do it like that. So 22.7, I'm going to go to the middle position. That's the HS2, and you could see it's 15. And if I go to the YJM, DeMarzio YJM, it's 22.9. And it's that simple. So DC resistance 22.9, DC resistance 15.1 for the HS2, and the HS3 is 22.7, which is pretty hot for a single coil. Okay, that, my fellow rockers, is how you check. And by the way, I'll tell you another little trick, okay? If you buy a guitar, or let's say you're looking for, I don't know, let's say I had this guitar on Reverb, and I say, hey, there's a YJM in the, or an HS3 in the bridge. One of the things you could do without taking the guitar apart is look up the spec of the HS3 and then do this little multimeter test. And it should be very close. I mean, if it's like 22.1 versus 22.3, you're right there. But if it's supposed to be 22.1 and it reads as 15, guess what? It's not an HS3. So it's a nice little way for you to determine what pickups are in a guitar without taking the guitar apart. Something else, if you don't own a multimeter, you should get one. In fact, I'll put a link in the description of something I recommend that won't break the bank. When I used to go to the record, I haven't gone to a recording studio in many years, but a lot of times I would bring my own amp head, and they have cabinets. But as you know, tube amps are real finicky with, you know, matching the impedance correctly, right? So if the amp says 8 ohms, right? Or if the amp says 16 ohms and you put 16 on your amp, but it's really 8 ohms or 4 ohms or something like that, you could damage the amp. So anytime before I plugged my amp head into somebody else's cabinet, I'd bring the multimeter with a cable, check the positive, negative, put it on an ohm meter, and I'll know exactly. Now I can't tell what speakers are in there, but I'll know what the impedance is. So another little trick for you. Okay, let me come back over here. Let's give this a go. Let's try this one out. So remember, HS3, HS2, YJM, and I'll just point to you as we go through the demonstration. Here we go. So here's another little interesting fact for you. The reason why they put the YJM in the neck is because it had more presence. It was more crisp than the HS3. So being that the neck position is like more bassy, right? More like has more bass tone to it. They put the pickup that's a little bit more sharp in that kind of bass position, so to speak. That's why they did that. Okay, let's hear what it sounds like on gain, and then I'll go to the next guitar. Actually, one of the things I'll do, they say this is really good to push a Marshall. So I have, you could see the purple light right there. So I have my Vintage Modern hooked up. Let's use the HS3 and the YJM to push that Marshall. So I'm going to change something on my amp selector, and let's hear what this bad boy could do to the Marshall. So that, my fellow rockers, again, is the Fender 60s reverse headstock Stratocaster, which you can't buy anymore, and the DiMarzio YJM, which you can't buy anymore as a YJM, although DiMarzio did rebrand it to the HS4. So you have a pickup that's been since rebranded and a guitar that they don't make. And if you do want this, you're looking at a Jimi Hendrix version. So what do you think so far? I showed you two guitars that you can't get anymore. Chucky Farley says, give away a Badlands tonight. I'll take one for review even. You know, I hope that we can do that someday. You know, our biggest limit right now is the ability to produce, because we're doing them here in the U.S., okay? And if we were doing imports, which we're not, you know, you could order 40 at a time, right? You could have a lot, and they don't cost a lot of money to make. And it's a lot easier to do giveaways and stuff like that. Our cost on these are pretty high. And, you know, our profit margin is pretty low. And it wasn't in the cards at launch to have extra guitars to do that sort of thing. But I really do hope someday we'll get there. You know, goals. Have some goals. Michael D says DiMarzio's make a string sing. I agree. Oh, Ian's Guitar Shack has the HS4. Do you like it? The dB meter, when I redid, you could kind of see I redid some stuff. So I put those racks out of the way on the side, and it's actually sitting behind my lamp. It's sitting back there. I just haven't hooked it up yet. I could hook it up, but I haven't yet. And I just wanted some more open floor space over here. That was one of my changes in the Tone Lounge for 2023. And I haven't hooked everything back up. I'd like to. I just haven't gotten around to it yet. So I'm glad you brought it up. Maybe by next week I'll have it hooked up. Thank you for asking. Okay, so we're about 46 minutes in, and I have two more guitars I want to show you. So I'm going to put this one down. And I'm going to have a beverage. Hang on. I wish I had a soda, but I don't want to run up to the garage and go grab one while you're all waiting for me. So I'm going to stick with my water. Okay, so two more guitars to go. One of them you can buy today. But let's go to guitar number three. By the way, are you all having fun? Is this a good show? And I ask you sincerely because it's always good to get a report card if this I'm hitting the mark and this is interesting to you and all that. So let me know. This is like Christmas come early. Okay, so guitar number three. This is guitar number three. There's a story here. If it looks like guitar number two, you would be correct. Good, everyone's having fun. Good, me too. I like telling stories. So guitar number three is basically a Fender 60s reverse headstock Stratocaster. I'm glad you didn't squeeze the water bottle. All your shows are awesome, especially Stone Thing, but cool guitars that you have. Thank you. Oh, thank you. Okay, so there's a story behind this. So remember, when these were being sold new, they were $699. And I'm pretty sure I got that other one on deal of the day. And I want to say it was like $500. After I bought that one, this showed up on eBay for $400, give or take. I don't remember the exact number. And the description went something like, "Hey, I bought the Fender 60s reverse headstock Stratocaster, and I installed SRV, Fender SRV custom shop pickups, okay? And I'm just not digging the guitar." And I think it was like $400. I was like, son of a gun. So I bought it. I knew it was going to disappear quick. So I wound up getting this because just like at the time in 2007, two of the guitars I always wanted was the Yngwie Malmsteen, which at the time I didn't own, and the SRV, which at the time I didn't own. So I figured, wow, this is like a score. So I wound up buying this one. Of course, I took it apart and I checked the resistance on the pickups and the label and the timestamp and everything, and it's all legit. Except this one has the Fender SRV. So basically, what I did with the Fender 60s reverse headstock Stratocaster is I turned one into a Yngwie Malmsteen guitar, and I turned the other one into an SRV guitar, Stevie Ray Vaughan guitar. And that's why I wound up keeping both. When I bought this one, I was the original plan, because I hadn't upgraded that one yet. The original plan was I'll take this one and send that back. But then I said, you know what? SRV, YJM, I'll have both. And I thought it was a good deal, you know. Does it have a 9.5 or a 12-inch radius neck? On this one, I could look it up. Hold on. I have the spec over here. I don't remember off the top of my head. This is. So the description on this is alder body, maple neck with 7.5-inch radius, 21 vintage style frets, one ply pick guard. Yep, one ply. Aged plastic parts, chrome hardware, vintage style bridge and tuning machines, three vintage style single coil pickups with staggered pull pieces, Alnico magnets, and aged covers with reverse slanted bridge pickup. Five position blade, 9 to 46. That's what the spec on this guitar is from 2007. And let me see something. Oh yeah, look at that. This is normally the other way. So this is repositioned. Okay. This is like opposite slanted. Okay. So let's hear, and that's why I have two of these. This was my poor man's SRV, and the other one was my poor man's Yngwie Malmsteen. And in the link of the description, I put a guitar that looks just like this that you could buy if you want to do something. Fender guitars are really easy to modify, and they're a lot cheaper than Gibson. So I did put a link if you wanted to do something like this, get one of these guitars to make your own and swap necks or pickups or whatever. It is new. You could always find it used, but the link is in the description if you're looking for a model number. Okay, I'm gonna plug this bad boy in, and let's see how the SRV pickups. By the way, I'm gonna tell you another secret here that even Fender won't tell you. When they sell, which by the way, I don't know why the Fender SRV only comes as custom shop, but it's about $300 for the set, to about 270 bucks for the set. It's only available as a custom shop, okay? And here's what's interesting. They sell it as a set, your bridge, your middle, and your neck. But they don't advertise it as such. However, the DC resistance for the bridge, the middle, and the neck are different. So if you have a Strat and you want to buy, let's say one SRV pickup and put it like in your neck or your bridge, you want to make sure you get the right one. And the resistance on the neck is about 5.9. The resistance on in the middle is 6.2, and the bridge is 6.5. So it gets a little hotter as you go down to the bridge, which is interesting. Okay, I'm going to kill the vocal mic. Let's hear how this boy sounds, and then I will go to the bonus guitar with the story on that. Thank you. So, my fellow rockers, now that it's on record, you could go check the timestamp and compare the Marzios to the Fender pickups. I think they sound different. They should sound different. They're different pickups, but I like them, you know, I like them both. So there it is. Let me put that one down. So those are three Fender guitars that you just can't buy. But you could certainly make your own and have fun making your own. And I think the biggest surprise for me was the parts caster, the first one I showed you. It was fun bumping into that. And the reason why it was fun for me is I don't know if I would have done that on my own. Okay. So now we're almost at the top of the hour. What I'd like to show you is a guitar that you could buy. It's not a guitar that you can buy. It's actually a guitar that you can. So for those that don't know, my birthday was February 2nd of this year. I turned 50 years old. Happy birthday to me. And I didn't know this existed, but you know, probably like all of you, every day I'm looking at all the manufacturer websites, I'm looking at my emails, I get, you know, press releases, all this stuff, and I'm looking at Sweetwater, Musicians Friend, Sam Ash, like all the retailers, I'm always looking at what's what, okay? I didn't even know this existed, but Fender made a 1973 reissue Stratocaster. And I was like, you know, I kind of felt like, and I give Fender credit. Oh, thank you for the birthday wishes. I give them credit. And I even asked my wife, I'm like, do you think they purposely released that for like people like me that turn 50 and want to treat themselves to something? She was like, yeah, probably. And if that's what they did, it worked because I treated myself to something. And that, my fellow rockers, is, nope, where is it? Wrong video. Oh, hold on, it's over here. Is this guitar right here, okay? That there is the Fender American Vintage 2 1973 Stratocaster in Lake Placid Blue, okay? Now, let me come back over here. I'll get it out. And this comes in a few different colors, but I like the blue the best. And interestingly enough, there's one on Reverb, a 1973 Fender Stratocaster in Lake Placid Blue. I think it's $10,000, something like that. And that was my 50-year-old birthday gift to myself, all because Fender came out with a guitar that said, hold on, where is it? 1973. So if Fender did that purposely, it worked. And trust me, I looked for other companies that made a 1973 guitar, and they were the only one. And when you turn 50, some of you already turned 50, I hope you treated yourself to something, and some of you probably haven't turned there yet, but when you turn to 50, you're going to want to treat yourself to something. It's a milestone, and I wanted something that said 1973, and goddamn, Fender was on it, and I think it was very intentional. you could buy this today. They're like $2,200. Actually, like all guitars I buy, I got a good deal on it. I've done a lot of videos on how you could get a deal too, so I'm just putting that out there. But I did get a good deal on this. I did not pay full retail. I bought this one as, you know, kind of a keepsake for turning 50. And this was my favorite one. Was the Lake Placid Blue. I just think it's a beautiful guitar. I'm going to give you a lick or two on this, and then we're going to wrap this video up. Here we go. My fellow rockers, that is your Fender American Vintage 2 1973 reissue Stratocaster. Which, by the way, I have one pet peeve. The case, the tip of the headstock is touching, as well as the lower part of the body, and nothing is supporting the body. So when this got delivered, if the delivery person dropped that on the headstock, I would have cracks by the neck joint. I don't know why. I think this is a G&G case, if I'm not mistaken. It might be. But whoever makes it, I don't know why it's so difficult to get the case right. This guitar, and you could even see that the headstock is pushing into that piece of foam. And that's a pretty hard piece of foam. I just don't know why, you know, it should be a better fitting case than it is. But it is what it is. It's the only thing I don't like about it is the case is just not a good fit. Okay. So, my fellow rockers, that is all I have for you this evening. I hope you enjoyed seeing three guitars, Fender guitars that you can't buy, and maybe perhaps even gave you some inspiration on some things you could do with your own guitar, you know, from having fun and discovery and just fun things you could do. I was really surprised with the parts caster. Love that guitar. By the way, Fender also ruined that guitar. In case you didn't see my little clip. Oops. That's because the Fender case had a nitrocellulose finish, and the case had like a rubber grommet that the guitar sat in, and it literally ate that finish away. So again, Fender case and a Fender guitar, and they had that little rubber grommet that ate the finish away on this. This guitar already had some nicks and chips and stuff like that when I got it, so I wasn't too torn. But let me tell you, if that happened to a guitar that I spent really good money on, like the 1973 Strat, I'd be raising hell. So the moral of the story is getting the right case is really important. Especially if you have like a nitrocellulose finish, and you see like a little rubber gasket that's supposed to provide some cushion for your guitar, don't do it, because it'll eat away at the finish just like that. And Fender, I mean, I should have this refinished and send them the bill. I mean, after all, it was a Fender case with a Fender guitar. It's like, come on, guys, get your stuff together. But anyway, RRD says, yeah, saw that show, the damn case. It just kills me. Here, I'll show you the case, hold on. And by the way, this is one of their premium cases, right? When I say premium, it has like those big mono rubber feet at the bottom. It's real thick. It's got the premium handle, right? And at the bottom, even the tags. Look at the little like Fender. These are like little Fender guitar pick things. So what do? They put this, even the neck support in here is better than that case they have over there. But what do at the bottom? Let me stand up. They put this little rubber gasket. You see that? See that rubber gasket? They put that rubber gasket so the strap button could sit in there, and it ate away the finish on the guitar. So now I have an automotive microfiber cloth that I put at the bottom. Like that. So the guitar doesn't touch that piece of plastic. And it just kills me why they can't get it right. And you know, I can't even really bitch about it because I bought the guitar used. I bought the case new. But I bought the guitar used, and they'll be like, well, it's not under warranty and it's used and blah, blah, blah. But it's like, listen, man, I'm of the opinion if you like religiously buy, you know, it's like buying a Ford car and then a Ford product and then it messes up your car. Like if you're sticking with the same brand, nothing should be messing up any guitar that they make. Because, listen, not everybody buys expensive cases. You know, a lot of people buy like dust cover cases. That actually happens to be a good gig bag. I just don't know why they would do that. It doesn't make sense to me. This is a company that makes guitars with nitrocellulose lacquer finish. I don't know why they would have done it. And here I am. They made that guitar. They put that guitar, their guitar, in worse condition because of their case. And it kills me. But it is what it is, as they say. Anyway, I'll get off my soapbox now. But that does piss me off. I got to be honest with you. That kind of drives me crazy. Deep breath. All right. Vampiric Spirit says, what happened? You got to hit rewind. I'm not going to go through it again. You know why they do it? Come on, man. Yeah, because it's cheap. It's, you know, they import stuff. And it's the left hand doesn't know the right hand is coming. They probably got a good deal. They imported it. You know, people, the people that probably imported don't, you know, the dots aren't connected. I'm sure that case is made in China, which is fine, by the way. But there should be some disclosure or something. Like, for instance, they put some nice embroidery and they put some nice things. Like, put a tag. Do not put a Fender Nitro finish. Like, put an embroider a tag. Not for Nitro or something like that. You know, some warning, because I mean, Fender should know better than anybody that we guitar players buy used gear, and they can't ignore that. I know they're not in the business of selling used gear, but it's still theirs, and they should be thrilled that people have enthusiasm about owning Fender product. And whether they are obligated to support that or not, it's like, it's besides the point. A Fender product shouldn't break another Fender product. And that just drives me crazy. They're a big company. They have the means to do it right. They shouldn't be breaking things. And by the way, when I did that little YouTube video short, there were some people that wrote to me and said they had the same problem. And I told them, I said, dude, you know, write to Fender. I didn't. I just, you know, it was one of those, just let it go. It was a used guitar. I know how that's, I'm just going to get more aggravated, and I don't want to get more aggravated. So just chalk it up to lesson learned and sharing it with you, so you don't have to go through that, right? That's the lesson, and kind of paying it forward. Anyway, my fellow rockers, thank you so much for being here tonight. I really hope you enjoyed the story on these Fender guitars. Happen to love that despite my complaint about the case. I love all these guitars. I think they're great. Hopefully you got a little bit of ambition from this video to do something fun and creative with yours. Or go look for that parts caster. The parts are worth more than I paid for the guitar itself. I stumbled across it, but you should check them out. There's really cool parts caster stuff out there. And you'd be surprised. I certainly was when I got mine. So anyway, thank you so much, everyone, for being here. RRD says, great show. Happy 50th. Thank you so much. And thank you, everyone, for the birthday wishes. I appreciate it. Metalhead Hippie, Michael D. Michael D said, and it's a parts caster. If it were all stock, then the rage would be warranted. See, that's my problem. It's like I'm still outraged because their product ruined their finish. But I know where it goes if I picked up a phone. We all know where that goes. And I choose not to be more aggravated than I am. Anyway, the great Vanzini says, really good show tonight. Thank you. Ian's Guitar Shack, one of those bad boys right there. Sasso P, Grumpy Mike, thank you again, dude, for the super chat. Michael D, books around Grandpa Joe, Brian from Aragon, AQ Music, Guitar Man 45. And in case I missed you, we're going to do a group bad boy for everyone that tuned in tonight. Thank you so much for being here. I had fun as always. Hopefully you had fun. And I didn't ask you, but I'll ask you on the way out. If you could give me a thumbs up on the way out, I'd be very grateful. Thank you so much. Have a good weekend. Be safe. Rock on. And one of those. Take care.